but I was so afraid it would destroy our friendship.
Till then I'll lean on you. That's all I mean to do. Till I can make it on my own. Surely someday I'll look up and see the morning sun without another lonely night behind me.
She started dating Burt Reynolds, then the biggest film star in the USA.
And I'm here with a very special lady who is so shy that I may do the entire interview myself. Well, she hasn't had a hit in over 6 minutes. What is the last big hit that you've had?
Let's Get Together.
Let's Get Together was her last big hit. And and how much did it, I mean, how many did it sell?
I don't know.
Doesn't know. Well, you don't have to be quick to be a country star. You just have to be.
I remember him coming in and thinking, wow, this is a real star. I guess I never associated Mom with being a celebrity, and Burt was a real celebrity.
What are you going to sing?
A song, if I might say, that was written especially for you, that you know. It's a song called You and Me.
She was happy. She was doing things she wanted to do, and she seemed to just come alive.
We're going to hear You and Me.
I can feel his heart, it's beating softly. He just loved me so tenderly, but it should be.
They didn't get married, I think. Not that Mom didn't want to. She probably would have loved to.
It wasn't to be. She married a local businessman instead.
I think it was something she knew wasn't going to work out and married him anyway. And then, you know, realized that that was a mistake pretty soon afterward.
Kids say the darndest thing.
They split up after 44 days.
I think I was 7 years old when that happened. It was difficult.
That was the thing that she was most embarrassed about in her life, was the number of times she had been married. Because her belief was, you get married one time, and you stay married, and you die married to the same person.
So she did it again. She married him. And this time it was to be until death. The songwriter became her husband and manager.
Tammy and I had a long relationship, a wonderful relationship. We were married 20 years. And for the most part, the majority were great years.
The quest was over.
I can hear the rain, it's falling softly. As I watch him lying next to me.
Just 2 years before, she'd told Burt Reynolds this song was written for him. Her final marriage would split her family and friends.
She thought that it was going to turn out to be something totally different than what it did. But by then, she felt, I can't divorce again because of my fans. They're going to look at me this way.
So tender.
It just wasn't going to happen.
It should be you and me.
She picked him wrong. And that was her downfall. And anybody who knows her life knows that. That's not a great big secret. After she picked George Ritchie, she never had a chance to pick anything else. He gained control, and he kept control.
No, he can't say that it should be you.
Tammy was one who dared not be alone. In most instances, her relationships were dependent on her. I think she was used by every relationship she was involved in. She knew nothing but work and music. The cotton fields and music. She didn't know about the world.
I can remember when she would play Towns and she would feign an injury so that she could go to an emergency room and be given painkillers to get high. When her reputation for doing so became widespread, she stopped faking an injury. She would walk off a stage.
Somewhere in my jeans a little bit tighter.
Tammy was now a country legend, singing her repertoire of golden oldies and still cutting country albums that pleased her loyal audience. As the years rolled by, she became an institution. Then, out of the blue, something surprising shot her back to the top of the pops. For Tammy, 1968 all over again. Just like Billy Sherrill, the KLF could make her seem real while all around was artifice.
It was Jimmy who turned to me and said, what we need on this is Tammy Wynette. And I mean, completely ludicrous idea, sitting in this South London studio. And suddenly I could hear her voice. I could just hear it in my head and thinking, he's right, he's right. And within three calls, I was talking to Tammy Wynette. She said, yes, I'll do it. Met at the airport by her husband, who took me in his powder blue Jag to First Lady Acres. And the first thing I hear, is that you, Bill? I fall instantly in love with her. And we get to the studio, and she's got the headphones on, and she can't do it. She cannot sing in time to the track, and it's absolutely awful. And I'm thinking, this is a disaster. So what happens is, George Ritchie conducts her through the whole thing, and that worked. Well, sort of worked. Actually, it didn't work at all. But when I got back to Britain, and I just said, look, I'm sorry, I've completely failed. The whole thing is a disaster. But the engineer we worked with had got this new gear in, and within a couple of hours, it was sounding fantastic.
They called me up in Tennessee. They said, Tammy, stand by the jam. But if you don't like what they're going to do, better not stop them, cause they're coming.
She's used to singing about heartbreak, the woman's situation in white middle America, and suddenly she's got these lyrics. But she didn't bat an eyelid.
They're justified, and they're anxious, and they drive an ice fever.
But she did say it like she meant it.
Our grandchildren thought she was the king and queen of all the acts. She loved it. It was a great experience.
Bring the beat back!
It was number one in 22 countries.
Flew her over to this country to make the video, and we knew she wasn't a well woman, but she worked and worked and worked. And you could see she was completely, you know, broken, but she'd go back out there and she'd turn it on all over again.
By 1991, Tammy had had 17 major operations on her stomach. She was still touring non-stop.
She was just a very, very sick woman. Consequently, she was the strongest woman I'd ever known. Sometimes we would be on the bus and she would be hooked up to breathing machines and intravenous machines and oxygen and this and that and unplug herself and go out and sing. And I came to believe that the thing that kept Tammy alive was performing.
Tammy and George Jones had been estranged for years.
Tammy became very, very, very sick
and was in the hospital. And in fact, you know, I was called at like 2 or 3 in the morning to come and be prepared to write the obituary that she would not live through the night. Georgie went to the hospital to see Tammy, and of course she was unconscious. But when Tammy did wake up from the coma, she said that she dreamed that she saw George there. He said, "I want you to get better." He said, "I want to make another record with you." And it was the most nerve-wracking thing that you can imagine.
Golden ring, with one tiny little stone, cast the sun. For someone to take you home by itself. It's just a cold attack thing. Only love can make a golden ring.
It was just an unbelievably emotional thing. The last tour to England, I remember calling everybody in the family, all the daughters, Richie, her husband, and begging and crying for them not to let Tammy go on the tour. I was convinced that she would come back in a coffin.
My husband and I were flying over to England, and I got on the plane and I was walking through first class with my cases, and I looked over and I saw this woman, this very, very fragile little old woman. And then I went, oh my God, I realized that was Tammy.
We brought her in for a show the BBC did in Birmingham, and they had to literally carry her on stage. She was very, very ill.
She was so fragile. And that's the last time I ever saw her alive.
Precious memory.
Tammy was just 55 when she died in 1998. George Ritchie and her daughters fell out over the estate, control over which went to him, and over the circumstances of her death.
We asked for the body to be exhumed because we had hired a private detective and gotten some information on some medication. We always felt like that had something to do with her death, but it was never really proven.
Tammy was of the generation where she was strong, she was powerful, she could run her own career, but she always seemed to be getting involved with men and letting them run things for her. And I think to some degree that was her downfall.
Maybe she was telling herself, there is someone out there that's perfect and right for her. Even though, you know, she wasn't having the greatest time trying to find that person, she didn't want to give up. I don't think things turned out maybe quite exactly how she had planned. But I do think that she did finally find some peace.
She really paved the way for women writers. And, you know, she had such a great sense of style and carried herself so well that, you know, I always have sort of looked to her for, you know, guidance in a way for how to be a real live country star.
For her, country music was about being real. You have to do a lot of things to get a chance to be real in country music. You have to change your name and let people give you a different hairstyle and create this phony image that you have to carry around on your shoulders like a boulder the rest of your life just for the chance to be real. It's a mystery to me.